Bhagavaan Kapila Maharishi. Sage Kardama, son of Brahma, performed tapas for 10,000 years in praise of Lord Vishnu in order that he may be able to obey the orders of his father in the propagation of human species. Lord Vishnu was pleased with him and granted him his wish, saying that he would beget by his wife Devahuti 9 daughters and that Lord Vishnu himself would be born to him as a son. Sage Kardama had his ashrama at Bindu Sarovara, a beautiful spot of nature, which was surrounded by the river Saraswati. Swayambhuva Manu came there with his daughter Devahuti. He could not find a suitable match for his daughter anywhere, and on the advice of Narada, he found Kardama to be the proper person. He begged him to receive his daughter as wife, which the sage accepted on condition that he would be free to take to sannyasa as soon as a child was born. Devahuti served the sage for a long number of years with devotion and sacrifice. She was emaciated and her hair was all matted. She knew that her husband was the only vehicle through which she could cross the ocean of samsara. She left off all desires, anger, greed, etc., became pure, very sharp in attention, polite and vigilant. She was shining with lustre. The sage was much pleased with her and gave her divine vision and showed her all the merits she had acquired, as well as his own yogic powers also. Then, after seeing all these, she expressed her desire to have children. The sage, by his powers, gave her the original health and beauty which she possessed at the time of marriage. He created a celestial mansion, sitting in which they travelled, and he showed her all the beauty spots of the earth and heaven. Then she conceived and brought forth 9 daughters in one day. The sage gave away all the daughters to different sages in marriage and requested them to beget children. Then Devahuti became pregnant again, and Lord Vishnu was born as a son, and he was named Kapila. Sage Kardama took leave of his son and wife, became a recluse, went to the forest to perform tapas, and never returned. Devahuti regretted very much that her husband could have granted her liberation himself if she had only asked for it. But foolishly she asked for children. She requested her son Kapila to teach her the knowledge of the Supreme. Kapila explained to her about man, mind, soul, Purusha and Paramatman, the path of devotion and of meditation, the manifestations of the self, and the fall of man before and after birth. Devahuti inquired, "What is this feeling of I and mine? What is Prakriti, matter, and Purusha, spirit?" The following are a few of the points in the advice given by Bhagavan Kapila in his reply to Devahuti. Man is superior among all the living creatures because of the faculty of mind with which he is specially endowed. Mind is like a creeper which always wants something to cling on. When it clings on to objects, it creates bondage. When it clings on to the Supreme, it leads to liberation. So, mind is the cause for either bondage or liberation. When the mind becomes pure, it becomes indifferent to pain or pleasure. Mind equipped with the true knowledge, dispassion and devotion perceives the self, the Supreme, which is one and not two. Advayam. Devotion is an easy road to liberation. One should leave off attachments to objects, wife, husband, children, property, etc., and get attached to saints who lead us to liberation. Saints are patient, kind and calm. They have no enemies. They are righteous and they have unflinching devotion to the Lord. They take delight in telling and hearing the stories of the Lord. What is devotion? What is yoga? What are their methods? Devotion is the process by which the sense of body consciousness is dissolved. Association of Satpurushas helps devotion. Devotion gets intoxicated by hearing the glorious stories of the Lord. Some devotees go on telling the stories of the Lord. They will have no other avocation. They do not think of liberation even. By their intense devotion, they get liberated automatically. Purusha, the Supreme, is the soul. He is beginningless, without attributes. He is beyond Prakriti. He dwells in the hearts of all and is self-effulgent, Purusha, of his own free will and in a playful attitude gave shelter to Prakriti, consisting of three gunas. Then he became a prey to her charm. His knowledge got obscured. He forgot himself and was duped by the various attractive forms coming out of that Prakriti. Though he is other than Prakriti, by identification with her, he takes the doership of actions on himself through the gunas of Prakriti. Though the gunas of Prakriti are actually doing everything. This is the bondage which causes pain and pleasure, birth and death. Though really he is ever liberated and blissful. Prakriti is responsible for the soul identifying itself with the body, mind and senses. Prakriti consists of 24 components, which are the 5 gross elements, the 5 subtle elements, the 5 organs of sense perception, and the 5 organs of action, and the 4 components of antakarma. The 25th is the time factor. By the power of Maya, the Mahatattva, the cause of the universe was born from Prakriti, like the sprout in a seedling. Yoga comprises of doing one's allotted duty to the best of his ability, to shrink from doing prohibited acts, to be contented with whatever is obtained as the dispensation of God, to adore the feet of realized saints, to withdraw from pursuits of worldly possessions, to actively pursue after liberation, to take pure food in limited quantity, to dwell in seclusion, to practice non-violence in thought, word and deed, to speak the truth, to abstain from sexual acts, to do penance, keep the mind pure, study the scriptures, to worship a deity, to observe silence, to develop steadiness in posture, asana, to control the breath by slow degrees, to withdraw the senses from their objects, to direct the senses and the mind towards the heart, to uninterruptedly contemplate on the stories of the Lord, to observe some fasts, and to do charity. By these, the mind gets controlled, evil ways are eliminated, and contemplation on the Supreme achieved. For meditation, the seat must be arranged in a secluded, clean place, neither too high nor too low, with a mat of kusha grass, deer skin and cloth spread one over the other, soft and comfortable. The seeker must sit on it in a comfortable posture, the head, neck and body erect, hands joined and loosely thrown in front. The body must be steady, muscles relaxed and not stiff. The gaze must be on the tip of the nose. The breath must be cleared by consciously breathing in, holding the breath and slowly leaving it out. By controlling the breath, the mind gets purified and the body gets rid of its bad qualities and becomes light. When the mind gets pure, the senses get withdrawn from their objects. Attachments cease. Raga and Dvesha are eliminated. The mind becomes fit for meditation on the Supreme. Through concentration, the beauty of the Supreme Lord must be carefully studied. The cheerful face, lotus eyes, beautiful body bearing the disc, conch, mace and the blue lotus in the 4 hands are very attractive. He wears the yellow silk, bears the Srivatsa mark on the bosom, Kaustubam on the chest, Tulasi garland round the neck, jeweled ornaments on the hands, arms, ankles and has the crown on the head. His lotus feet rest on the heart of the devotees. Beautiful, attractive, and graceful as he is, he blesses his devotees. The devotee should first direct his gaze towards his lotus feet, from which the sacred Ganga flows out and adorns the locks of Lord Shiva, the feet which are the refuge of all jnanis and devotees. Then he should gaze on the legs, knees, thighs, loins, hips and belly, and the navel from which the lotus sprouts to give birth to the creator, Brahma. Then the chest with all the ornaments, the seat of goddess Lakshmi, the forearms with instruments, then his face, eyes, cheeks, lips, and lastly his smile, and the grace which flows from there. Having enjoyed all these, the seeker should no more desire to see anything else. All desires must end. He must turn his gaze inwards and observe the same Lord smiling in his own heart. By constant practice of this meditation, the seeker's love for the Lord increases. His devotion becomes strong. He experiences excessive joy. He gradually withdraws his mind from the object of meditation towards his own heart, and makes the mind dissolve in the heart as a flame gets extinguished when withdrawn into the very oil by which it burns. The mind becomes one with the heart. It ceases to think of anything. The seeker perceives only the infinite everywhere. All distinctions stop. Ignorance evaporates. Pain and pleasure run away. Absolute oneness prevails. He does not feel the body as his own. He attains the state of samadhi. The manifestation of the Supreme as consciousness increases from the lowest to the highest in the following order: inanimate objects as stones, animals, animals with movement, animals gifted with sense of taste like fish, with smell, bees, with sound, snakes, with form, crows, animals with teeth in upper and lower jaws, creatures with many feet, with 4 feet, with 2 feet, man, man of any one of the 4 castes, the Brahmin who knows the Vedas, the Brahmin who understands the Vedas, the Brahmin who knows the essence of the Vedas with conviction. Still higher is the man who performs his duties without attachments. Then one who has dedicated all his actions to the Lord. Above him is one who has no sense of doership and sees no difference between the Lord and any other creature. A devotee should bow to that Lord who is a controller in every living organism. To worship a stone and to hate a living creature is hypocrisy. A man who hates other living beings can have no peace. Devotion with cruelty to animals, animal sacrifice, is of the lowest type. Devotion for material gains comes next. Devotion as a duty is superior. Uninterrupted devotion without a motive, ever-flowing love to the Supreme, is bhakti yoga. A real devotee will not accept, even when offered by the Lord himself, salokya, samipya, sarupya and sayujya. Such a devotee becomes himself the Self, the Supreme. The fall of man begins when he thinks that his wife is the dearest to him and places his sperm in her generative fluid, where the sperm unites with the ovum in one night. In 5 days, it forms a bubble. In 10 days, it is hard like a plum and develops like an egg. In a month, the head is formed. In 2 months, hands, feet and limbs are formed. In 3 months, nails, fingers, toes, hair, skin, bones and organs of generation are formed. 4th month, all the several human elements are formed. 5th month, hunger and thirst are felt. 6th month, the fetus is covered by fluid and the legs begin to move inside the belly. It derives food from the mother and grows. It suffers agony inside the belly. Sometimes it swoons. The mother's food affects it badly. By the seventh month, it gets consciousness and finds itself in great bondage, unable to move. It remembers its previous births, and with that knowledge, it prays with the joined hands to the Lord for release. By the 10th month, the child, with head below and face downwards, is pushed out by force of time and is born with great torture and agony and loss of memory amidst blood and dirt, and it begins to cry out. After birth, it is fed by others than itself, with what may be agreeable or not agreeable. It lies in a bed of ants and bugs, cannot scratch or express itself. It depends for everything upon others. As it grows, it depends on the mother, father, brothers, sisters, wife or husband, children and grandchildren. Slowly and unconsciously, it develops this dependency. This is pure attachment. This attachment develops because he has no knowledge of himself or others. He thinks himself to be the body and the others also as bodies. This "I am the body" feeling begets attachment, which he cannot leave off. And this attachment is the cause for rebirth and the birth after birth. When this attachment of dependency is shaped with knowledge, where self-knowledge dawns, there the path of liberation opens out. Hearing all these from her son, Bhagavan Kapila, Devahuti lost all body consciousness, forgot her husband and son, became a tapasvin and attained liberation from rebirth.